Don't forget to check out our sponsor, The Help Blaze, at thehelpblaze.com. 100% all natural products from lotions, soaps, foot soaks, bath bombs, and much, much more. Use the promo code Goodfella1Boxing. Tell them your boy CJ Goodfella sent you, get 18% off. We out. All right, let's talk about The Last Dance Part 3 and 4. Give my reaction to it, man, and kind of tell you guys what they missed in 3 and 4. So hit that subscribe button, bell icon button, share the video. Appreciate the love, support. I'll throw these reactions in our NBA talk playlist. I did one for 1 and 2. And, you know, I still feel like it really ain't hit its stride yet. As far as the doc, it's pretty good. I don't think it's exceptional yet, but maybe in its entirety, it'll be exceptional. But basically kicked off about Dennis Rodman and, you know, how he got off to a slow start, you know, in the 98 season, you know, leading up to the 98 championship they won. I think it was the 97-98 season, and how Scottie was out and how Dennis stepped up and how important Dennis was to the Bulls. You know, today, in today's basketball, people think if you don't score the basketball, you ain't important to a basketball team. The dudes like Dikembe Mutombo, Ben Wallace would have been underappreciated by today's basketball fan. All right, and then as people look at Dennis Rodman didn't score no points, or he didn't shoot no threes, or he didn't, you know, hit no layups. But what he did was the dirty work. You gotta have guys to do the dirty work like Dennis Rodman, you know, if you want to have a dynasty. You might win a championship without him, but you gotta have the dudes to do the dirty work. You gotta control the boards. You gotta get on there. And Dennis Rodman was defending some of the all-time great centers and big men in the league. You know, people talking about Jordan didn't play against this guy or that guy. Man, you forget that was the golden era of big men, you know, from when Bill Russell played to Wilt to Kareem. And don't forget, he guarded Kareem. People forget that. Kareem, Ewing, Hakeem, Shaquille O'Neal, you know, the Karl Malones was out there. And I'm missing a lot of other big fellas that end up coming to the league, the Webbers, it was a great time for big men. And that's the difference. Jordan took the big man away from the league and made it a guard league. So now Jordan and Dirk got big men, the big guys that want to be guards. And you can credit that a little bit to Kevin Garnett as well. Kevin Garnett, Dirk, and Jordan all made big men want to be guards. They glorified the guard position. And before Jordan, it was all about the big fella. That's why Sam Bowie and Akeem went before him. But Dennis Rodman just showed he's the most versatile defender in NBA history. You know what I'm saying? He can guard fives, fours, threes, twos, ones. He can guard the combo guard throughout his career, and he was very, very important on defending, on, you know, getting the dirty ball, getting the 50-50 ball, rebounding. You know, he was very setting screens and communicating on defense. Anybody play organized basketball, the one thing that's universal for great defensive teams is communication. You know, calling out screens, calling out picks, calling out down screens, and, oh, I got him, switch. That's very important, and I think they needed that portion. I think it should have been a little bit more extensive on Dennis Rodman, so how important Dennis Rodman was. It was a direct correlation from the Bad Boys to Dennis Rodman, how important Rodman really was to those teams defensively. Without Rodman, the Pistons don't beat them. Ain't the Pistons. Without Rodman and making that move, the Bulls don't continue to win. You know, but it, you know, went on to, you know, how Jordan trusted Rodman and, you know, and all that type of stuff. And eventually Scottie did come back. But then they would go back into the past and kind of talk about how they got over the hump versus Cleveland and how he hit that shot on Craig Elo. And that was an iconic moment for Jordan. That was one of his first series. And people forget he was an underdog. People say, well, the East, you know, Craig Elo was a white boy. Well, you see more white boys back then because more white boys can play. You know what I'm saying? Mark Price is one of the most underappreciated guards, man. You've seen in a few of them highlights, Mark Price was getting bucketed. That Cleveland team was pretty freaking good. That's why they was the 3 seed. The only reason they wasn't 1, I think, because Detroit was the 1 seed. But, you know, yeah, Mark Price, man, go back and watch him. Y'all talk about Steve Nash. Mark Price off the pick and roll was just as deadly. May it be getting to the rim and finishing. May it be shooting a 3. Mark Price was one of the baddest white boys nobody talked about. Brad Daughtry, Larry Nance Sr., they had a nice team there. And they were struggling with Cleveland because Cleveland was the better team. Scottie hadn't emerged yet. He was coming, but he hadn't emerged. And Jordan hit that shot. That was iconic. You know, you've seen it. You know, Jordan missed free throws. It happens. They want to make it seem like Jordan never missed a shot. Go back to when they played Boston, when he could have, when he scored 63 and he missed the shot to win the game in regulation. They lost in the overtime. Peep that. Peep how he's playing golf with Danny Ainge from the last part one, part one, part two. Peep that. Peep how he missed a free throw. He missed a free throw. I think it was they was playing Cleveland, or it could have been Detroit. He missed that free throw the other night, yesterday. You know, Jordan missed free throws, and he missed big shots, but he made more than he missed. And when he missed, it didn't come back and bite him in a critical moment. But, you know, they got into the Cleveland situation and how they transitioned from Doug to Phil Jackson because Doug Collins didn't want to basically listen to their offensive coordinator, a guy that drew up the triangle. And people seen how Jerry Cross really gave Phil Jackson this opportunity because he embraced the offense and how, you know, Phil, you know, had to show Michael, you know, how to, you know, pretty much how to embrace and use his teammates through the triangle offense. And Michael didn't want to do it, you know, but Michael had no other choice because he was getting his ass whooped by the Pistons. Now, I'm going to hold off on the Pistons. I'm going to give y'all the real in a second. And I'm going to see what to tell y'all what they left out. But, you know, and he had to get Michael to trust his teammates and pass the ball. And that's what the triangle was about. It's not, you know, Michael was like James Harden. He getting all these points and playing isolation basketball and not utilizing his teammates, but he was fucking losing. He might have beat Cleveland, okay. But he was going to lose unless he used his teammates. Unless he drove and they crashed the defense on him and he let Scotty become the point forward that Scotty could be. And Scotty started, you know, facilitating a little bit. And he trusted Scotty. He trusted Paxson. You know, eventually you touch Kukoc and Ron Harper. So when he started trusting his teammates and making the extra pass, well, defenses couldn't fuck with the Bulls no more because you had to respect Jordan driving to the lane, and now he kicking it, and now he got shooters. So that's what the offense is about. Phil Jackson, I mean, Doug Collins, and he coached in Detroit. I remember the Taco Bell commercials he used to have. He coached in Detroit in the 90s, the teal Jordans and the burgundy Jordans. I mean, teal jerseys and the burgundy jerseys. He was all about isolation, Michael. And they wasn't going to win that way. And he didn't want to embrace the triangle, so they got him the fuck up out of there. And that was the best move you can make. So when they started embracing the triangle and moving the ball, they gave the Pistons even more trouble. But that wasn't the biggest difference between them doing the Breakfast Club and lifting weights and getting stronger, and they really didn't hone in how Scotty had a migraine and how he bitched out in one of them Pistons series. You see how they trying to make Jordan and Scotty look like superheroes? You know what I'm saying? Like they did Dr. Dre and Straight Outta Compton, try to make him look like a superhero. They didn't really go into the detail about that, but yeah, they were physical and they embraced the bad boy thing. And the thing about it was they let you know that they finally got over the hump and they swept them. But what they didn't tell you is how the NBA added an expansion team, the Timberwolves, and they stripped them of Brick Mahorn. Now, if you go back and look after they won the championship, and when they took Rick Mahorn and put him on expansion Timberwolves, Isaiah said, the bad boys are done. We'll never be another bad boy team without Rick Mahorn. So they got rid of Rick Mahorn. And if you notice, when they lost to the Pistons, you know, I think the first time it was all about, what was it all about? It was all about, oh, they filing hard. Or, you know, it wasn't no fines or no flagrants or no technicals back then. Fast forward, when they fouled Scotty in the 91 playoffs, they got a flagrant. Where did flagrants come from? The bad boys. Flagrants, techs. David Stern didn't put that in to protect Magic. He didn't put it in to protect Kareem. He didn't put it in to protect Larry. He didn't put it in to protect Wilt. You know, 10, 12 years before that, 15, 20 years before that with Bill Russell, not George Mikan, not Pete Maravich, not Elgin Baylor, not Jamal Wilkes. You can go on. Not George Gervin, not Daryl Dawkins, not Kevin Willis, not Dominique Wilkins. He didn't put the fucking flagrants and techs in for Magic or Bird because ask James Worthy. Them Boston Celtics were just as physical. They did the same thing. But when Detroit do it, it's like, oh, Detroit not supposed to be here. Oh, they ain't part of the plans. Indiana, Detroit, Milwaukee, they really ain't supposed to get no championships. We got to get Kareem to L.A. You pay attention to that? That's the problem with the NBA. They don't want the Clevelands to win a championship. They ain't want Cleveland to win that championship, only because LeBron's on the team. They don't want Orlando to win a championship. They don't want Oklahoma City, New Orleans to win a championship, Sacramento to win championships. They don't want them small market teams to win a championship. And I always said the NBA should just get rid of the small market teams if they're not going to have an equal chance to win. And that's why people know what Tim Donaghy said about the NBA is rigged. So David Stern put flagrants and texts in the game, so they won't be as physical with Michael Jordan. You see how they kind of transitioned and said, oh, he started lifting weights and all that shit? Man, I want to administer pain. Well, only pain you administered was getting David Stern to make sure that Rick Mahorn was off that team and getting David Stern to put flagrants and texts in the game so you wouldn't have to be on your ass no more. So the Pistons couldn't get physical no more with you. That's what happened. They took Rick Mahorn, and then they also took the physicality out the game where you couldn't elbow or nothing like that. That shit had been going on in the NBA way before the Pistons did it, but the Pistons became the poster child of it because they weren't supposed to be there. That's the problem. So when the small market team there fucking up the ratings and fucking up the money, they gonna stop that. So they tell you how he ran to David Stern and cried about, oh, they trying to kill me and they trying to hurt me. They trying to make it seem like this motherfucker started lifting weights and added 15 pounds, and he started administering pain. Hell no, they stripped that team of Rick Mahorn. They changed the rules as far as flagrants and texts and how physical you can be. That's why. And they put suspensions in there. That's what happened. Tell the whole story, ESPN. You see how they trying to make Jordan and Pippen look? They should have honed in on how Scottie quit and had a migraine like a pussy. They ain't really honed in on that, but that's what really happened. Not saying that Jordan wasn't eventually going to get over the hump, but he didn't organically get over the hump. And another thing you've seen, he was beating old people. That Piston team without Mahorn, and they was older. They had made 3 or 4 straight runs to the finals. I believe it was 3, and they had 4 runs from the Eastern Conference where they should have went to the finals 4 times in a row and probably won all 4, at least 3 of them. But obviously, Bird stole the ball. They gave a phantom call on Kareem, and Isaiah hurt his ankle, and then they won the latter 2. But one thing you notice is Jordan didn't beat nobody at his prime on his travel through to win the championship. He beat an older Piston team with help from David Stern. He beat an older Laker team in 91. And what they didn't show was how Magic Johnson was cooking his ass, and that's why Scottie had to get on him. It was a reason why you see Jordan start on Magic, and then you seen Scottie end up shutting Magic down. See, Jordan was getting dog walked by Magic. Magic didn't want to give up the motherfucking mantle because just 2 years before that, Magic was MVP. People forget that. So that's why Scottie was on Magic. And then they got into, you know, Phil Jackson being the Zen Master, and you know, pretty much Jerry Krause continue to put pressure on the team, and you know, tell them that it was over with and that, you know, Phil won't be back, and Magic and Michael like, well, I ain't coming back without Phil and this, that, and the third. So, you know, you kind of see how Jerry Krause destroyed that team and then never was able to build it back up. He was there since 2003. He was just never able to build it back up. He was just a total asshole. And that's kind of where most relationships break up at. This is where you see Bill Belichick and Brady break up at. The arrogance. They just can continue to dominate. They got to prove to each other that I don't need you and I can do it without you. And that's what it was with Jerry Krause. Oh, I don't need Phil. If it weren't for me, Phil, Michael, Scottie, none of you motherfuckers be here. It was about me. And when the arrogance kick in and when you don't have a selfless creator like Jerry Krause, this is what you get. Little man complex. And he was never able to create that. He could have put two more championships at least on his, we talked about that on the last part one, the part two review. He could have put 2 more championships on his mantle. But he wanted to break a team up. He wanted to rebuild so fast. But Michaels and Scotties don't come around and Phil Jackson's don't come around. What Phil do? He ended up joining the Lakers and winning what? He three-peated with them. They won 3. And then, you know, he won 2 more with motherfucking with Kobe at the end. So he ended up still having a great career. Other than the little blemish with the New York Knicks. But who don't do going to New York and GMing or coaching for the Knicks or going, you know, working with James Dolan, that's like the Bermuda Triangle, bro. Your career get lost in a minute, no matter what accolades you got. But, you know, they kind of went through that and how eventually he got over the hump And I like how they played the cool mode D when they got over the hump. How you like me now? That was another guy that probably possibly beat LL Cool J, but Cool J won that battle off popularity just like cannabis. But, you know, they did get over the hump. They showed the maturation process of how they finally got their first ring in 91. And people was asking, like, how did Magic and Lakers, you know, they make it? Because Green had long retired. In the East, and best way I could put it, and I'm going to make another comment, I'm going to get off. The West was like the East when LeBron was going through it. You know, you had Terry Porter, Clyde Drexler, you had, you know, Hakeem trying to find their way and stuff. The West wasn't dominant back then. The East was the dominant conference with Reggie and the Pacers and the Ewing and the Knicks. And, you know, Michael stayed killing the damn Knicks. You know what I'm saying? And Phil Jackson first game there. I mean, Doug Collins, he killed the Knicks. It's Doug Collins' first game there, but it was tougher. You still had Dominique going around there and doing his thing, so the Pistons still was around. The East was way tougher, and you know, back then, and the West was, you know, it was a breeze for the most part, you know. So that was a difference. But one thing I'm gonna say, man, when Phil implemented that triangle offense, if Phil Jackson implemented that triangle offense to LeBron James, LeBron would have had him fired like he had David Blatt fired, Mike Brown fired. LeBron would have had Triangle Field fired off the rip. What is this triangle offense bull job he trying to put in here? LeBron do not want to be without the ball. And that just show you the difference. Michael Jordan was open mind. He said, you know what? I don't need the ball. Let me see if this works. And he seen that with Field implemented, started to work. He ran with it. LeBron wasn't trying to see shit try but work without the ball in his hand. That's why they fired Bill Wardenboy. You know what I'm saying? His son. What's his name? Whatever his son's name is. You know, Luke Walton. That's why they fired Luke Walton, because Luke Walton was letting Brandon Ingram and Lonzo control the ball. And LeBron was like, this is some bullshit. If I ain't got the ball in my hand, man, fire this coach. And that's the God honest truth. So if Triangle Field would have tried to come in that shit with LeBron, LeBron would have had Triangle Field fired. He wouldn't even have had no career. So let me know what you guys think. You thought about the review. What you think about the video. Don't feel me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. You can reach out to me if you have a business question, query, response, your video question, just want to chop it up. Twitter the quickest way. Want to make a donation to the channel. Cash App, PayPal, description. Best way to donate is share the video. Check our NBA Talk playlist for more videos like this. One time for the one time we go.